A very warm welcome, everyone. On behalf of Team NEHA CSP, we have a very good teacher with us, Dr. Nitin Nagraj. He's personally one of my favorite teachers at NEHA's. Brief introduction about him. Sir is an associate professor with NEHA's Consciousness Studies program. He has a bachelor's in electric and electronics engineering from National Institute of Technology, Karnataka, and also a master's in electrical engineering from RPI, Troy, New York. And he did his PhD from NEHA's. And I recently came to know that he was one of the bright students of NEHA's who finished his PhD within 3.5 years. So yeah, he has experience in both in corporate and in teaching. He was a faculty in IASER Pune and also in Amrita University. He has corporate experience working as a research assistant, scientist and lead scientist in GE Global Research. Sir has many facets and patent applications under his wings. His personal interests include popularizing mathematical thinking, study of Indian scriptures, especially Vedanta, and the practice of Atma Vichar. This is a very short introduction about Nitin, sir. There are many more qualities to him that you'll see while he's giving his lecture. So over to you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Niharika. So good morning, everyone. And I think Niharika has raised the expectations quite a bit, and I hope I won't be disappointed now. But I think, so firstly, I think I would like to sort of thank Professor Sangeeta because she gave this opportunity to deliver this talk. And I think I benefited a lot in preparing for the talk, you know. So I was looking at my journey and about writing and research. So I think it's a great exercise for me. I hope I'll be able to share some of those insights with you. And I should also thank Niharika, Meera, and Ashwini, who actually are the backbone for the whole course, right? I mean, they're making the course happen. So thanks to them. And I know that Dr. Madhurima has done an excellent job in her sessions. So I thought I will figure out something slightly different from writing per se. So I'll just share my screen. Just give me a minute. Yeah. Just a second. Is this visible to everybody?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. So. Okay. Yeah. So the title of my talk is From Good Reading to Great Writing. By the way, Niharika, my voice is fine, right?
Yes, sir. We can hear you fine, sir.
Okay. Yeah. Just let me know if there's any problems at any time. Yeah.
Sure, sir.
The title of my talk that I advertised was From Good Reading to Great Writing. And I thought I will probably deviate a bit from this in some sense, you can say. The reason being that Dr. Madhurima has already done an excellent job. I thought I will try and talk slightly. I'll zoom out. You know, I'm going to sort of zoom out of writing a little bit and then talk about writing in the context of research, you know, and then what at least my personal journey has been. So let's begin the journey. Just a second, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Firstly, I think let me give a disclaimer. I think it's very important to make this point very clear that what I'm going to present to you today is a very personal point of view. It is a very, very personal point of view. It is my point of view and shaped by my experience. And it's obviously biased by my background. And as you know that I'm an engineer slash mathematician by training. And so that is going to inform all my insights. And so while what I say may be not directly applicable to the social sciences and humanities and you know, philosophy and other branches, I'm sure that some aspects of my journey will be, you will be able to resonate with it. But I thought I should make it very clear that, it's very much a science engineering point of view. And at the same time, I would like to also invite you to be critical. At the same time, be very open. Okay. So don't accept everything that I say without testing it in your own journey. And I think I'm reminded of Buddha's words. And I think this actually goes back to the Gaanavyuha Sutra, which where Buddha actually advises monks and disciples. He says that, look, O bhikshus and the wise, just as a goldsmith tests his gold by burning, cutting and rubbing it, so you must examine my words and accept them, but not merely out of reverence. So it's a very, very important point that Buddha is saying. Don't accept anything that I say just because I am saying it, you know, that I am Buddha saying it. You have to test it by burning, cutting, rubbing, as a goldsmith will accept gold, right? Like whether it's 24 carat or 14 carat or whatever, you know. So, I mean, I'm not the Buddha, but obviously if it's true for Buddha, definitely it's true for a mere mortal like me. So everything that I say, please take it with critical, examination. At the same time, be open. I think it's important to be open. Otherwise, you know, you have to consider the possibility that what I'm saying might be applicable to you. Okay. So that's what I would like to say. Yeah. So this is the plan of my today's session. As I said, I'm going to zoom out a little bit and give a little slightly different view of writing, because I think that writing in itself is a cog in the wheel, right? I mean, it's one of the aspects of research, but there's a lot more to research. There is reading and there is other aspects of research, which I'm going to talk about. And so my plan is I'll talk a little bit about research, the way I see it. It's my point of view. And then I talk about reading, the important aspects of reading. And then we'll get into writing, a little bit of writing as well. But the writing part will be actually less, you know. So hopefully what you get out of today's session is going to be complementary to what you learned from Dr. Madhurimada's sessions, you know, her wonderful sessions, very exhaustive, very thorough sessions. I think what you get from my session will be like a complementary, hopefully complementary to that, her sessions. And the bonus today is, I thought I will talk a little bit about two things. One is the most important ingredient, and I will come to that in the end of the lecture. And what I call is unofficial scoop, you know, what I mean by that is some things which we hesitate to talk about, you know, the controversies, the discrimination, the kind of tricky things which happen, the behind the scenes, you know, all the messy things in research, publishing. And I'm going to talk about from my experience, from my data, you know. So that's why I call it unofficial scoop. So it's very much a personal story, obviously. But I'm sure that many of you can hopefully relate to it and gain by that experience, right? Because they say that, right? That wise people learn from others' mistakes and fools learn from their own mistakes. So I'm a fool and I've learned from my mistakes, but you can be wise and you could learn from my mistakes and my learnings, right? So that's the idea basically. Okay, so let's begin. Now the research process, right? As I would like to call it. And I was thinking, what is a good metaphor? What is a good picture? What is a good template for research? And I could go back to, I mean, there are several templates I could use, but the template that I really like the best goes back to the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. In the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, there is this discussion on the nature of reality, which is universal consciousness. And the question is, how do you comprehend it? How do you dwell upon it? How do you establish yourself in consciousness, in universal consciousness? And there the Rishi proposes three steps, you can say. Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana. Okay, Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana, 1, 2, and 3. And I thought that this template is very much a template for research as well. Okay, and I'll tell you what I mean by that. Why it is applicable to research as well. Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana. Okay, so, and as you can see that the three of them are connected, you know, it's not that the three are, it's very difficult to find a boundary, right? Look at these three spirals here, which are connected. It's not the case that you can separate it very cleanly. There are overlapping boundaries and research process is very much iterative. So you might have to do Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana, all of them in one session, in one day, for example, you know. So it's not that these are like different stages. Think of them more like labels to guide you, you know, rather than anything. It's a guideline, you know. It's not strictly written in stone, but it's a guideline for research. So, and you know very much many of these. It's not that, it's anything new actually. So Shravana basically is what? It's about listening, right? Shravana means to listen. And in the research process, it can be mapped to reading, listening to lectures, watching YouTube lectures. So for example, you're you're listening to my words today. That's going to be part of Shravana. Googling, consulting peers, solving out problems in a book, you know. I mean, you're just sort of scouting the area. You're just exploring the terrain. You are listening, you're open, you don't have any conceptions, you don't have any questions to ask, not yet at least. You're just curious, you're open-minded. So being open-minded and being curious are probably the most important aspects of Shravana, right? And the second step would be manana. The second step in the process is where you go a little bit deeper, right? You go into critical thinking. You now ask the question, okay, this guy is saying something. Is it true? Is it valid? Is it, you are doubting it, you're questioning it, you're analyzing it, you might write a computer program to verify it out, to test it out. You might build a prototype. For example, if you're an engineer, then you might build a prototype. You want to understand. So the goal of manana is more to gain a deeper understanding into the what you've read already, what you've heard already. And you have lots of doubts, lot of questions, and you're a skeptic, and that's how it should be, right? You should not, as the Buddha is saying, right? The cutting, the scrubbing, the scratching, the melting, you know, you're doing all that. That's the manana phase of things, you know. And then the third thing is nidhyasana. Now, here is where I think the key word here is synthesis. Okay. So you start to now integrate different aspects of your learning. What you have learned just now and what you've analyzed and what you already have learned it maybe several years ago, maybe, you know, you're synthesizing, you're integrating, you're doing creative thinking, you're having a new formulation, a new design. You may validate, you may falsify, you may model something, you know, a new model maybe. You might come up with a theorem, a proof, you might come up with an argument, you may implement something. So nididhyasana is, in some sense, you can say the deepest part of research. And remember what I told you earlier, that all the three steps are iterative in nature. So you might do 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, or 2, 3, 3, 1, 1, 3, 2. I mean, you could do it in that order. I mean, there's no fixed order here, but you juggle through these three different steps of research, you know. And I thought that this is probably a good template, the Upanishadic template of Shravana Manana Nididhyasana. Now, the question that you might ask is, what is the difference between any questions so far? Maybe let me just pause here. I don't want it to be a monologue. So, I mean, we have a lot of time. So,
yeah. If there are questions, you may please type it out in the chat box or raise your hands.
Yeah.
So I can easily unmute you. Narasimha Murthy says, Narasimha Murthy says it's all clear.
Okay. Thank you.
There are any questions, please type it out.
Comments, suggestions, you know, because,
yeah. Dr. Shamishtha Dhar has, I think, a comment or a question. Ma'am, you're unmuted. Please go ahead.
Sir, my question to you is, since you deliberated or you dwelt for some time upon this threefold procedure of Sravan, Manana, Nididhyasana as espoused by the Advaita Vedanta scheme. So my question to you is, since Nididhyasana, when they were talking about Nididhyasana, they actually focused on meditation upon the truth, what has already been learned. So from that perspective, when you were dealing with the issue of Nididhyasana, you're talking about you're synthesizing the truth and you're computing, programming, etc.
Yes.
How do you reconcile between the Advaitic conception of Nididhyasana? Because there the goal was to obtain truth. Tattvagyana was the goal there, the samambona of life, and which actually paved the way for liberation or emancipation.
Yes.
So in the present day context of understanding Western research methodology, how do we reconcile between that Nididhyasana and this kind of
That's a very, very, very good question. You know, very deep and very nice question. I think, so first comment I will make before I answer your question, the comment I'll make is that any analogy or any template has limitations, you know, so it may not fully fit in. But now to answer your question, I think the point of convergence between the Nididhyasana of the Upanishads, now remember, Upanishads are the Vedanta, right? I mean, Advaita is an interpretation of the Vedanta. So there would be a Dvaitic interpretation also for the same verse, you know. Anyway, that's just a side point. The point I want to make here is that what you said is right, though. What you said is very correct. The truth, right? You use the word truth. I think that is exactly the essence of research, right? You have a question about some aspect of reality, some aspect of nature, reality, universe. It can be physics. It can be the mind. It can be sociology. It doesn't matter, right? So you're trying to actually figure out the truth, you know, or a truth. Let me put it as a truth, and that's exactly what Nityasana is about, right? You want to dwell upon the truth. You want to establish yourself in the truth. You want to discover the truth. You want to make the truth your own, you know. That's exactly what the same thing is true in research as well. The idea is not so much that you already have a preconceived idea and you want to fit it to that. It's more like you're trying to discover the truth, you know, and that's exactly true with research as well, right? Because when I'm trying to formulate a new theorem or a new proof, the theorem may be wrong, right? And when I try to prove it, I may end up actually proving the contrary, you know, I might end up proving it true. That's also fine. That's also actually a valid theorem, you know? So I think the key word here, I would like to answer your question is, the key word is truth here, you know, a truth or the truth, you know, if you want to have a relative point of view, you can say a truth. So that is probably the point of contact between Nididhyasana and modern day research, you know. The goal has to be the truth, you know. It can't be a fancy, it can't be a narrative, you know. Of course, there will always be biases, there will always be a subjective point of view. That's all there. I'm not saying it's not there. But as much as possible, you want to unearth, you know, what is out there, what is true, right? That's the kind of thing, you know. I'm sorry, it's a long answer, but we'll come back to many of these things later, you know. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Ma'am, is there a follow-up question or?
Yes, another question. Question is also pertaining to your understanding of the concept of Manan. Manan, at times, Manan is treated as equivalent to Vichar. Would you treat Manan as a technique or method of research, or do you think it's research methodology par excellence?
I definitely would put methodology, methods as an aid to Manana. It is not Manana itself. It is a tool. It's an apparatus or a tool or a you know, a device to help you to do Manana, you know. That is how I would look at it. And you could use different methodologies, right? I mean, each discipline has its own methods, right? Each has its own way of questioning. Each has its own way of thinking. It has its own way of analysis. It has its own way of prototyping. It has its own computer language, right? I mean, own syntax, own semantics, you know? So I would say that Manana would be the methods would definitely come in here. But methods are a tool for Mananam, you know? It is not Manana itself. Because remember, Manana is a conscious activity. It's not a mechanical activity. It's a conscious activity which encompasses understanding and comprehension, and you know, it's a conscious activity, so it's not mechanized. So tools are just mechanical in nature. You use the tool artistically and with artistic aesthetically. You use the tool to investigate, basically, you know. That's how I would look at it. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there are 2-3 more questions. Would you like to take them now?
Yeah, we can take them now. No problem. Okay. We have enough time.
I'm unmuting Kanchan. Ma'am, please go ahead with your question.
Maybe keep it short so that we can, that we can move forward. Yeah.
Thank you for this. I just wanted to ask that it depends on the methodology that we are using. Yes. So do you think there is a scope? There is a lot of, so I come from literature background. Earlier, I thought you were from mathematics and I cannot associate with you at all because I'm very bad at it. But the moment you brought this up and I'm in my literature research, I always felt that in literary theory, there is always scope to have this kind of interpretation, at least for the text, which are inclining towards like the kind of truth, search for truth and all. Mm-hmm. So do you think that we can weave a research methodology instead of calling it Eastern and Western? There is a scope to weave research methodology, considering Shravana Manana and Nididhyasana, considering our goals or kind of text that we are interpreting. The question may pertain to interpretation or hermeneutics in literature, particularly.
Yeah, I would, as I said, again, you know, I'm not an expert, so I don't know whether I can answer your question satisfactorily, but with my limited understanding, I think it should be possible. What you're saying is very reasonable, you know. So hermeneutics is definitely, I think, would fit into this category. I mean, this kind of a way of thinking and doing research. So I would think the answer is yes. But again, I'm not an expert. I'm just coming from my background, but I think you're on the right track, you know.
Next question, sir. We'll just take one more question. This is by Shivang Gini. I hope I'm pronouncing your name right. I'm trying to unmute you. You had a question about Manan.
Please go ahead. Yeah.
Ma'am, are you here in the meeting?
or they can type it, you know.
Yeah, so sir, the question is, please repeat the manan by linking Nididhyasana.
Sorry, say that again.
Please repeat manan by linking Nididhyasana.
Okay, yeah, so I think the way to understand, at least my understanding of manana Nididhyasana is the words are analysis and synthesis, you know. So in manana, you're not really synthesizing anything novel or anything, you're not integrating, you may not necessarily, you know. You are analyzing, you are trying to take the data from the Shravan part and you're putting it to test. You are questioning it, you are doubting it, you're investigating it, you're analyzing it, you know. Whereas, or the analogy I can think of is, if manan is like scissors, right? You're cutting stuff. Nididhyasana is more like a needle, you know. You're trying to stitch together things. But you need both scissors and needle, right? To come up with a nice cloth, with a nice... embroidery. I mean, you need both. You need scissors and the needle. So manan is more analysis, and the Nididhyasana is more synthesis. You are trying to link what you already know, and you're trying to synthesize. You're trying to integrate. You're trying to come up with something creative. You're trying to validate. I mean, you know. So with what you already know, or you're trying to falsify. So Nididhyasana is where I would say the creative aspect of research comes in. But again, as I said earlier, these are not tight compartments, you know. These are not tight compartments because at any given point of time, you might be switching between them. You may be switching between analysis and synthesis very rapidly. So you may not be able to compartmentalize it. As I said, these are just guidelines. Just remember that these are just guidelines and milestones. I mean, these are not really meant to constrain you, rather to help you and enable you, empower you, you know. That's how I would look at it, yeah. Okay, so we'll move forward. So Niharika, you can just tell people that we will ensure that all questions are answered either later or, you know, either through email or, you know, so nobody will be left unanswered, you know.
Yeah, sir. Okay.
We'll try and ensure that. Okay. Now the question comes in as to how would you define, again, you know, this is again a very, very personal point of view. And by no means, I'm claiming that this is universal. How would we define the difference between applied research and fundamental or basic research, you know? And that's a question that I would encourage all of you to ask for yourself. And I will provide you with one answer. I mean, it is a answer. It is not the answer. It is one answer. And just to help you think about it. So the answer that I really liked was given to me by my guide, actually, my advisor, my PhD advisor, Professor Prabhakar Vaidya. He was in NIAS and I did PhD under him. And he defined it in a very beautiful way. The definition is quite simple. Applied research is very, very simple. He used this phrase, idhar kamal udhar, udhar kamal idhar. That's what he said. You know, he said, look, applied research is you are just tinkering with stuff. It doesn't mean that it is low. It's not condescending. It's not pejorative. It is the fact, right, that you're tinkering with things. You are trying to apply stuff from A to B or B to A, you know, from field A to field B. For example, you might apply number theory to graph theory. You might apply, optimization to neural networks, whatever. I mean, you're applying stuff. You're doing idhar kamal, udhar kamal, idhar. Now, whereas fundamental research, what he said is very, very interesting. His point is that what new can you say about the most fundamental elements of your field? The words here are new and fundamental. Okay, those are the two keywords here. And I'll give you some examples. The best way to understand is examples, right? Look at space and time. I mean, we think that we all know what space, what time is, right? And since time of Galileo and Newton, you know, I mean, people had a conception of time and space, even the best physicists, you know. Now, Einstein came and said completely different stuff out of it. In 1905, he wrote four papers, actually, which were amazing papers. And in one of the papers, he completely reworked the notion of space and time itself, you know. I mean, that is mind-blowing, right? I mean, space and time are so fundamental. I mean, and he's saying something new about it. He's saying, look, you people have a wrong understanding of space and time. Here is what it is, you know. It's a different conception of space and time. And what is amazing about Einstein's paper, 1905 paper, is that the paper has no references. Just imagine, it's a research paper. It has no references because who will you refer, right? He's telling something fundamental about space and time, you know. And same thing is true with his other paper on the equivalence principle, right? The E equal to mc square, where matter and energy are shown to be equivalent. Now, again, you know, matter and energy were thought to be understood in physics. But here comes Einstein and gives a completely new formulation of the equivalence between them. Same thing you can say with Maxwell, right? Electricity and magnetism were thought to be different. But then he integrated them and he said it's one unified electromagnetism, electromagnetic force, right? That's again a fundamental thing about what he said about knew about electricity and magnetism. Darwin, right, about life, about species. Shannon in 1948 about information. Again, we use the word information very loosely, but Shannon came and said, look, information can be quantified. It can be mathematized. It can be precisely defined. And just like, for example, you have mass, right? Mass, you can measure mass using units, right? Like kilograms, grams, milligrams. What Shannon said is information is something similar. It can be measured and it has a fundamental unit. The unit is actually bits or whatever, you know? And there's a precise definition of one unit of information, you know? So again, very, very fundamental, right? Now, Turing came up with the notion of computing and very, very fundamental. He said something new about computing. Same thing can be said about prime numbers, pendulum, the simple pendulum, RC circuit, I mean, mind, consciousness, dreams. For example, when Freud came up with his theory of interpretation of dreams, I mean, in some sense, he came up with a fundamentally new way of looking at dreams, right? I mean, he synthesized, new theory of looking at it. Same thing with sleep or other aspects of reality, right? So this is what is meant by fundamental research. This is one point of view that the basic research is, what can you say new about something which is already known in the field, you know, which already people know and they think that they know, everybody thinks that they know about it. But here comes somebody and they say, oh, no, what you know is wrong. It's not complete, it's incomplete. And here is a newer picture of it, a complete picture of it. That I think is one way of defining fundamental research. But again, as I said earlier, one need not have this hierarchy between applied and fundamental. Both are important. Both are valid, both are important, both are valued, and I'm not putting anything down here. I'm just saying that these are the ways to look at research, you know, fundamental and basic, fundamental and applied research. Now, I think I'm just going to refer to one amazing speech by Richard Hamming. Now, Richard Hamming was a Bell scientist, a Bell Labs research scientist. He was an electrical engineer and he came up with this, what is called as Hamming codes, you know. Anyway, that's not important for this talk here. But of course, his work actually revolutionized the way information is transmitted across different channels. For example, your mobile phones today use something which Hamming actually invented. Not exactly what Hamming directly invented, but Hamming created this field of error correction codes. And today's deep space communication and internet and DVDs and CDs and mobile phones, they all use his algorithm in one way or the other, or rather the theory that he built, you know. So he comes up with this very beautiful article, a very beautiful talk called You and Your Research. And I would encourage you to read it, you know, because I don't have the time to go through all his insights here, but I thought that I should refer to this and I should, and later after this session, I will share this material with you with the help of Niharika. We will share all this material for all the students. It's an amazing piece of talk, and he's basically asking the questions. So if you notice here, he's saying, why do so few scientists make significant contributions and so many are forgotten in the long run? So he's basically asking the question that how come some people are remembered for their work, right? It can be Einstein, it can be Fourier, it can be Ampere, it can be Watt, it can be, you can take your pick, right? Sociologists or psychologists, I mean, your favorite philosopher, you know? How come some people are remembered, but some are not? Why is it that, you know, that is the case? And he tries to come up with some examples and some answers for that, you know, why they were successful and they created a lasting impact, whereas other people really did not, you know, do that much. It's a very beautiful take, and you know, I sort of would urge you to read it. Okay. Now the question is, let's get back to the course, right? How do you write better? Now that's the central question of this course. You want to be able to write in a more effective manner, in a more influential manner. You want to convey something very, very important. You want to convey as succinctly, as concisely. You want to inspire people maybe, right? So the question is, how do you write better? And the answer to this is very interesting. The answer to this actually is very simple and interesting is, the analogy is music, you know? So any musician, I'm pretty sure that in the participants, there are several musicians here. I am not a musician myself. I did try learning the violin, but I gave it up. I'm a failed musician. What my guru told me though, when I started learning music is, if you want to sing well, if you want to play the violin well, what you need to do is you need to hear more music, hear a lot of music, you know. Similarly, if you want to write better, the answer is you have to read better. That's as simple as that, you know. It's very, very simple, right? If you want to write better, you have to read better. In other words, what you read, how you read, those are the two aspects, right? The what and the how. What you read and how you read are the most important ingredients for writing well, you know. So basically, it's very simple, right? Garbage in, garbage out, right? If you read horrible things, you will end up writing horrible things, you know. If you read very good work, if you read amazing work, you the chances that you'll write better is also higher, you know. So the central crux of writing is reading, you know. The central crux of music, for example, is to listen to good music. Listen to good music, listen to a lot of music, listen to immerse yourself in music. Same thing is true with reading, writing also. And the more you read, the better it becomes. And this is true even in my own life, you know, that as my reading improved over a period of time, I also noticed that my writing improved because I had more examples to draw from. I could cite better. I could draw from disparate sources because I had read, not just reading in my own discipline, I'm saying, you know, you can be eclectic. You can read, I mean, I'm a scientist, right? I'm an engineer, but I would like to read philosophy, Vedanta, literature, poetry, arts. I mean, you know, there's no barrier, there's no boundaries, you know. You read more, you read widely, you can get inspired from that. You can get inspired from that. So that's the point. So the question is what to read, right? Now, again, in some sense, you can say this, you can map it to the Shramana aspect of it. Now, what to read is important. And I'll tell you how to read. Both are important, what to read and how to read. The what to read is, what is very surprising to many people is, people talk about reading the latest papers, you know, keeping up with the times, right? The cutting edge, the bleeding edge technology or the papers in the latest journals. Now, the advice that I got and what I found useful is just the opposite of that. Okay, don't spend too much time reading the latest things. In fact, the point is very different. Read the basics, you know, read the basics. Be very, very strong in your basics, you know. Read the most important concept in your field. And most importantly, read the first article in the topic, the first article. And that article can be very old. It can be 100 years old. It can be 1,000 years old. It can be 500 years old. I don't know. I mean, but read that first article, you know. Don't read, I mean, of course, you can also read the latest articles. I'm not saying you should not. But what you will gain more by reading the first article is immense, you know. Read the first article on the topic. That's very, very, very important, you know. The first article, the first paper, the first thesis, the first book, the first essay that was written on the topic. That is the key, you know. That is the key to doing good work. And of course, you have to read and yeah. Now, I'll give you some examples. These are just examples, remember. And these are very, very biased and very, very personal examples. Obviously, in your discipline, you will have to do the same thing for your discipline. But I'm just giving you 10 examples, and these are the pillars. That's why I have the picture of a pillar here. These are like breakthrough papers. These are like fundamental papers. These are papers which started a field, which initiated a field, you know, which posed a new question, which started a whole bunch of work from then on, you know. For example, the 1948 paper of Shannon. It's a classic paper to read, you know. The 1965 paper by Cooley and Tuckey on the fast Fourier transforms. Now fast Fourier transform revolutionized everything that we know in technology, you know. I mean, everything today is running because of the FFT algorithm, you know. Public cryptography, Brownian motion, quantum theory. I mean, the list is long. The list is very long. I'm just giving you a few examples here. Lorentz 1963 paper, that was the birth of chaos theory. 1989 paper by Nagel, what is it like to be a bat? That's one of very, very important paper in philosophy of mind. 1944 book actually by von Neumann and Morgenstern, The Theory of Games. Ramanujan's work, of course, Ramanujan was known to do extraordinary work, but there's something called the circle method, which is a very, very powerful technique in number theory, and 1918 paper, actually, you know, if you look at it. These are just examples, remember, these are not by no means exhaustive. So my point to you is, my advice to you, all of you here is, go back to the foundation of your work, you know, if it's literature or sociology, or it doesn't matter what it is, go and read the original. Let's say the original is in German or Latin or Sanskrit or local languages, Tamil, Telugu, it doesn't matter. Go and read that, you know, go and read that. Get a translator, read that, you know. Don't read the modern textbooks of which are interpreting that, because the modern textbooks will flavor it, will color it with their own understanding, with their own interpretation, you know. Read that work which that person had written. He or she had written it with a particular idea in mind, with a particular motivation, with a particular context. Go and read the original, you know. That is very, very important, you know, and you'll have to take the trouble, you'll have to take the pain, you know. See, my Sanskrit is very, very poor, you know. I mean, I did learn Sanskrit in high school and this one. It's not very good. But I sort of try to read Adi Shankara's commentaries on the Bhagavad Gita in his original thing, and it's available. In fact, I found very strange that his Sanskrit is quite simple to understand, actually, you know. Whereas the modern scholars, I may be very difficult to read, you know. But of course, I'm just an amateur Vedantin, but I'm just giving an example. I'm just trying to tell you that go and read the originals, you know. go into the ordinals in that language if you can. I know that you'll have to learn a new language, but why not? I mean, if it's worth the, I think it's worth the trouble, you know. So read the first and the most important work in that area. That's the point that I wanted to make, you know. Now, what? Okay, another question you might ask is, how do you know what's a great paper, right? I mean, that's the question one can ask. What is a great paper? What is, and the answer is not very easy to answer this because there's no fixed structure. There's no formula. You cannot just say that it's a great paper. Sometimes, you know, papers are known to become famous much later. For example, Fourier's work, right? It never became famous when he was alive. You know, it became famous after he died, and 200 years after, even now we refer to his work. You know, but when he was alive, it was not that famous. You know, it was okay. You know, I'm pretty sure that's true with many of the historians and literature people. And it might not be famous, so it's very difficult to identify it. But I'll give you some features. Again, it's not exhaustive by any means. It's just my understanding of it. One is, of course, you can ask the question, how many citations you can look at it. Again, it's a very bad, it's not necessarily a good measure because it's not a foolproof measure, but sometimes it's true, right? Some papers are cited heavily and it's because it's really a good paper and it might have created a new field. It has initiated a new field, you know. It could have solved a new problem. It could have solved a problem which was outstanding problem for hundreds of years. Hence, it's a very, very important paper. Or importantly, it's posed a new problem. So for example, if you read David Chalmers' paper in 1995, he actually poses a new problem. I mean, it's not really a new problem, but a new formulation of a problem. He's talking about the hard problem of consciousness, you know. I mean, until then, people knew the problem, but the way he formulated it is so amazing that even today, people refer to Chalmers' paper as the hard problem of consciousness, you know, the 1995 paper. So the posing a new problem or a new formulation in such a way that it inspires a generation of scientists and researchers to do great work, you know, that is actually a great paper to read. Does it generate a controversy? Very, very important question to ask. For example, Galileo's writings, right? In the 1600s, where he favored heliocentrism. And heliocentrism was obviously looked down upon by the church. And, you know, he was put under house arrest and all that stuff. Obviously, it created a controversy, right? I mean, and you'll find such examples in every era, you know. For example, if you look at the recent work of Donald Hoffman. Now, Donald Hoffman is this cognitive scientist in University of California. He has come up with a theory of consciousness where he's questioning physics itself. He's saying that space and time are an illusion, you know. And he has very, very good arguments from biology to back it up. But it's creating a controversy, right? Because, you know, it's a clash of the ideas. It's a clash of ideologies. It's a clash of ideas. So it's generating a controversy in that sense. It's a good thing. It's a good thing, you know. Does it shake the very foundations of our worldview? You read Einstein's paper. I mean, every one of his papers are shaking the very foundations of what we think is space, what we think is time, what we think is gravity, what we think is mass. I mean, no longer we can hold on to our cherished worldviews, you know. They are deeply questioned, they're deeply shaken. Sometimes they're shattered to bits and pieces, you know. So that would be a great paper to read, you know. But of course, it doesn't mean that it is correct. I mean, the paper might shake the foundations, but it might be wrong. That's okay. I mean, you'll have to judge for yourself whether it's right or wrong, you know. It should be inspiring, you know. It should be inspiring. It should not be depressing. It should be inspiring. It should make you do more work, you know. It should be beautiful. It should be elegant. At least that for me is very, very important. To me, research is very aesthetic, you know. It's very artistic. Mathematics to me is very aesthetic, you know. When I read a mathematical paper, the question that I ask is not just that it is true. Is it true? I'm asking the question, is it beautiful, you know? Is it beautiful? Is it elegant? Is it aesthetically pleasing? Very much like music or the painting, you know, work of art. So beauty is very, very important for scientists, you know. That is amazing, right? And probably many of you probably don't know this because you're in the other fields, you're in humanities or social sciences or arts, but mathematics is driven by beauty as much as driven by consistency and completeness and truth, you know. Then the question you can ask is, does it move you very deeply and emotionally, you know, very much like art? It should sort of shake your deepest form of your personality, you know. It should not be just information. It should not be just an algorithm or a method, you know. It should move you to tears, you know. Literally, if you're reading a good paper, you actually cry, you know. That's my experience, actually. It has enormous applications, maybe. Maybe it has no applications, right? If you read Ramanujan's work, nobody knew that Ramanujan's work could be applied for the black holes today, you know. It could be applied for in DNA research. Nobody knew that. It was intriguing. It had no applications when he invented it. But today, people are finding applications. So it's not necessary that it should have applications. It's puzzling, it's intriguing, it's amazing. In fact, when Ramanujan's work, when Hardy looked at it, he made the statement that it has to be true because it's so beautiful, you know. It is so beautiful, it's so puzzling. How could anybody imagine this, you know? That was the question that he was asking. It imagines the impossible, you know. That is the beauty of it, right? That what you think is impossible, it's actually imagined. And I'm pretty sure that when you read poetry of Kalidasa or Shakespeare or whatever, I'm pretty sure you get the same feeling, right? That this is impossible. And I mean, how is a person even able to imagine like that, right? The metaphors, the similes, the analogy, the context, the characters, whatever it may be, you know, I mean, how do you even imagine something like that? So the last but not the least, I would say, is very, very important as a researcher, is that the great paper is not trivial, but you feel that you could have done it, you know. Now, that is very, very important for me, because many times I read a paper and I feel, oh, this is too complex. It's too complicated. It's too complex. How could anybody, I mean, I couldn't have done this, you know. I usually find that very, very off-putting, and it does not inspire me, you know. I would always want something which I feel, oh, I could have done this, you know, why didn't I think of this, you know. I find those papers are more inspiring and more beautiful. But of course, it's just a personal choice, you know. But I found this question to ask. You can also ask the question, could I have done this myself, you know. That's a question that you can ask, okay. So I thought I'll give you an example of a great paper. Again, you know, by no means, this is the only example. I thought I'll just pick an example. There's so many examples. Actually, I could have taken an example in physics or biology or engineering, you know. So I thought I took an example in cryptography. There are some reasons why I took this example. It'll become very clear very soon. This paper was published in 1979 by Adi Shamir. Now, Shamir, you may not have heard of this name, but you're using this technology every day, you know. You don't know that, but you're using it. Shamir was one of the inventors of the RSA algorithm. I'm pretty sure that you might have heard of the RSA algorithm. S stands for Shamir. It's an algorithm for public key cryptography. So whenever you buy things on Amazon, when you do e-banking, you're using a concept which Shamir invented, you know. So everybody today is using it, you know. And he came up with this paper in 1979. It's about sharing secrets. It was actually it initiated a new field in cryptography. And it's actually very much important for example, for sharing missile launch codes. Say you have nuclear missile codes. Now you don't want the code in one person's hands, right? You don't want it just in the president's hands or the prime minister's hands. You want the code to be such that multiple people should come together to unlock the lock, right? That is the idea of sharing a secret. You don't want one madman. If the person goes mad, you know, that person can just pull the trigger, right? You don't want that to happen. You want the secret to be split into parts, 3 or 4 or 5 parts, and share it into 5 people, because then, you know, even if 2 or 3 people become insane, you know, the remaining people are able to manage it, you know. Now, the reason I shared this paper is, one is, of course, it has many citations, but can anybody guess how many pages is this paper, you know? Can anybody take a guess? It has 15,000 citations. It created a new field. How many pages do you think this paper has? I mean, you can just type it in the chat box. Let me just...
Some are 10 to 5, 10 to 20.
Okay.
15, 4.
Okay. Yeah, we'll just wait for two more minutes. 1 more minute, maybe.
8, 2.
Okay.
6. 20.
Okay. Great. Fantastic.
1.
Okay. Yeah. So the answer actually is very close to 2. The answer is 2 actually. So the answer is 2. And I think some of you got it right. So it's amazing, right? It just, that means that in one back-to-back A4 size of sheet of paper, you can take a printout of this paper, you know, that's it. It's just an A4 sheet of paper back-to-back. And it has some 4 or 5 references, you know, that's all, because it's a new area. It's a completely new problem he's posing and solving it. So not only did he pose the problem, but he solved the problem also. And he gave a mathematical proof as well. Not only did he solve it, he gave a mathematical proof of it. It's just two pages. So I thought I'll give such an example, because that means that what is very important to remember here is that a great paper may be very short. So the size does not really matter, you know, here, you know. What really matters is the depth of the thinking, the insight, the beauty of the paper. You know, so just remember that, you know. So that means in your entire life, you might write only 2 pages, but those 2 pages can make all the difference, you know. That's the message that I want to take home here. So congratulations to all those people who said 2. I think some of you said one, so I couldn't find an example for one, but I'm pretty sure that there should be examples where a great paper was written in one page. And I'm pretty sure there should be some examples like that. I could not find immediately. I'm pretty sure that you couldn't find it. One page paper could also be earth shattering, right? It definitely it's possible, I think. Okay, great. Should we pause here for some questions, Niharika? I think let's just take a few questions here.
It's a good time
to pause here. Yeah.
If there are any questions.
Just a pause. I want to, yeah. And I want to see your faces if I can. So.
Yes. Please type it out or you can raise your hands. Okay, there's one hand raised by Narasimha Murthy. Sir, I'm trying to unmute you. Please go ahead.
Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah.
Hello, sir. Yeah, thank you very much. Like so far, it's been really great, your lecture, your class. So like my question is, I agree with you, like to read the original, the original, like Advaita or, you know, any Vedas or Upanishad. But like Sanskrit, see, I'm also not very good at Sanskrit. I can manage, I can read. But like how to find, you know, the very close translation to any original text? Like what is your take on this one? Because lot of all classics are written either in Latin or German or Sanskrit, and how to choose the very closest, you know, which does not distort the real, you know, the scripture or.
It's a very, very good question. Narasimhamurthy, it's a very good question. And unfortunately, again, I'm not an expert because, I mean, I work on stuff which are luckily written in English, you know, most of the times. But to answer your question, I think what I would suggest is, you will have to spend time reading many different authors who are commenting on that paper. That will give you some idea, maybe. That will give you some averaging, right? You're looking at multiple interpretations, multiple translations, maybe. Of course, that will still be a loss. There will still be a loss in information, right? Because you're not read the original. I don't know. It is a problem. It is a problem that you'll have to deal with, like you said, Latin or, you know. See, if my point is very simple, okay, if something is so important to you, you should learn that language. There's no excuse, you know. I mean, I know it sounds hard, but spend the time, spend a few years reading it, learning that language, you know, because if you really, really, if the work is really important to you, you should learn that language, you know, because there will be a loss of information for sure by the translators, you know. There's no way that, so you'll have to figure it out. I mean, you know, you'll have to make a choice then, okay. Okay, I'm going to learn Latin for the next 2 years. You know, you'll have to make the choice. If something is so important, you have to spend time reading it. You know, that's just my point of view. Again, as I said, you know, luckily for me, you know, most of my work is in English. So my main piece of work, you know, my Vedanta is not really my area of research, but when I read, they're all written in English, luckily for me. But even there, you know, when I read Chinese papers or, you know, people by Chinese authors, I find that language difficult, you know. See, one thing you can do is if the person is alive, then you can email that person, right? If the person is alive,
yeah, that's fine.
But you were talking about Latin, Greek or Sanskrit, you know, you don't have that luxury. But suggestion is spend time knowing that language. If it's so important, you have to learn it, right? There's no shortcuts, you know. Remember, research is a very long process, you know. It nothing happens in a year or two, you know. So I don't know if that answered your question, but that's my point of view, you know. Yeah, we can take some more, maybe.
Yeah, that's very honest.
Yeah, no problem, yeah.
Very honest.
Any more questions? We can take maybe two more questions, maybe?
Yes, another question by Sandhya. Ma'am, I'm trying to unmute you.
Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Please go ahead, yeah.
Namaste to all of you. I'm Dr. Sandhya. I'm an Ayurvedic professor and I'm a consultant too. Sir, to answer to Mr. Narasimhamurthy sir's query, because I am dealing with Ayurveda and I have been, because all our classics are in Sanskrit only. So my suggestion to Narasimhamurthy sir is that many a times, even if we try to learn the language, it would take ages to learn, or it would take quite a long time to learn it. Instead, the easiest method is if you can come in contact with a person, for example, Sanskrit. Any Sanskrit scholars or who have done their MA in Sanskrit or who are able to deal with Sanskrit better, if you can just communicate with them and then check with the translation, they can give you a translation for this, it is a lot better. That's what I do, because many a times we have books in our classics which are written in English, in Hindi, in various languages. But when we go to the commentaries of the Sanskrit original text, it's again in Sanskrit alone. So to find the actual meaning, because the commentaries, the English or the other translations, we feel that it's totally distorted and gives a very vague meaning, which might not be applicable at all. So it would be better if, for Sanskrit things especially, because I'm dealing with that. So I would suggest that you tackle with this with a Sanskrit scholar. You will get better information about whatever you're dealing with.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Sir, I'll just read two questions. Uh-huh. The first one is, Yeah, the question is, sir, do you think adding more references to a research paper makes it more authentic?
Not necessarily. It has to be relevant, no? It has to be relevant references and it has to be appropriate and So, I mean, definitely, I don't think that would definitely make it, It has to be relevant, it has to be appropriate, it has to be contextual and timely and all that, you know. Otherwise, it doesn't necessarily make it authentic, Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Another question is, any site for search for one specific subject? I think there are various research sites available if you...
Correct. Yeah, Niharika, you probably know better, I guess. Yeah. See, I mean, I can tell you some stuff regarding of course, you have to start with the journals in the field that you are journals, papers, articles in your area. So there won't be any one single site for all subjects, obviously, right? So, yeah.
Like you can go on JSTOR, LibGen. There are various ones. In the group, I might be able to share it on the WhatsApp group. I'll try my best to share the sites that I usually visit. So, sir, I don't see any other questions in the chat box for now. We can.
We'll continue. Yeah, I'll just go back to my sharing again. Yeah, it is visible, right, Niharika?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, so slide 18. Yeah, so basically, I'm talking about how to. So, I talked about the what, right? If you recall, I just told you that. Let's go back here. Yeah, so because when we said that we have to read better, I basically told you that there are two points here. One is what to read and how to read, right? There are two aspects to it. The what question is somewhat answered to some extent, right? That the point that I'm trying to make is read the first article, paper, book, thesis, essay, whatever in that topic, if you can. And the problem of language and translation, all these are, there are issues, obviously. But I think there's still worth the effort is my point of view. And then we talked about this. Now the question is, and I just gave an example, a simple example, a two page paper. Now the question is how to read better. It's not like it's again a suggestion or a recommendation, not necessarily the, you can say a foolproof technique, but it definitely helps. It's called a three-pass method. And it is actually taken from this paper, How to Read a Paper by a computer scientist called Keshav. He's a Canadian professor, and it's actually a very short paper. It's again a two-page paper, and he's telling about this three-pass method. Again, later through Niharika, I will share this paper with everybody. The idea is very, very simple. The idea is that you basically do three passes, at least three passes, you know, three iterations, three passes. The first pass basically is you just read it, the title, the keywords, the abstract, the introduction, the titles of the sections, not the section themselves. Conclusions, and then glance the references. It may take 5 to 10 minutes to do it, right? Because the first pass is trying to filter out the paper. You're just trying to see whether is the paper really important for you? Is it really relevant, important? What category does it belong to? What are the contributions of this paper? What kind of, is it well written? Is it important paper? Is it an important contribution? Is it correct? You know, you're just sort of seeing at a very high level, a bird's eye view. And you're not going to the details of the paper. You're just trying to get a feel for it. And you may not do the second and the third pass if you find it's not important or not relevant for you. At this point in time, you just don't go to the second or the third pass. If it's relevant, if it's important, then you do the second pass. Now, second pass is where you go deeper. You go deeper, you read it with greater care. You mark references here. You mark them saying, okay, I'm going to read these references. I'm going to follow them up. You can mark references which you already know, and you mark references which you don't know also. And you take notes in the margin, you focus on the graphs, the tables, the captions. You go much deeper in the second pass, you know. Now, second pass obviously is done with the idea that you want to understand the paper, you want to sort of really evaluate the paper, right? You want to be able to come to the conclusion, okay, this is what the paper is doing, you know, this is what it's trying to argue, this is the structure of the argument, the details of that, you know. And yeah, so this is actually an important pass. And this pass also, after this pass, you may not do the third pass. You may stop here. The third pass is where it's very, very interesting, is where you rework, re-implement the paper. For example, you might have to write a piece of software, a program. You might have to start with the assumptions of the authors and then try to argue, try to go through the arguments, recreate the work, basically, re-implement the work. And you ask the question, have you presented the same idea of the work? Are there any missing citations? Is there any possibility of future work? So the third pass is really the core of the research thing, right? You're really, really going and reworking the whole paper, you know, as if you are doing the work yourself, you know. You're recreating it, re-implementing it, testing it out. So you're going all the way. In the second pass, you don't do that. In the second pass, you're just understanding it. So it's also, you can see that this is also very much like your Shravana Manasyasana kind of thing, you know. The first pass is more like reading. The second pass is understanding, analyzing. The third pass is where you're integrating, synthesizing, validating, implementing, evaluating, you know. It's again, you can say, you can map it to the three, the Vedantic process, Shravana Manasyasana process, you know. So again, very, very commonsensical, right? Nothing, I mean, you probably know this already, but I thought it's good to be aware of it as a guideline, as something which will help you, you know. Okay, we'll move forward. Yeah, so this is actually an interesting thing I found. I found it to be very, very beneficial. This person is called Larry McKerney. He's actually the director of the University of Chicago's writing program. And he has a few talks on YouTube. I've given a link here, and I'm going to share the slides with everybody, so you don't have to write them down. You can, I'll share the slides with you, so you can go to this link and click it. And it's actually like an 1.5 hours talk. And he has a few talks on writing effectively. Frankly, when I saw it, it really helped me a lot. I had a lot of misconceptions and it helped me quite a bit, you know. So I'm not going to say anything that he's saying. So all the information that I'm giving you here is complimentary to that. So you can go through his talk and then it'll benefit you profoundly, you know. So several aspects of writing he talks about. And I'm pretty sure that Dr. Madhuruma might have covered some of it, or maybe all of it also. I don't know. But maybe it's definitely worthwhile watching it. I can tell you that I benefited by watching Larry McKerney's talk, you know. Okay, so we'll go forward now. You know, in some sense, we're going out of writing again. We're going to the manana part of it. Again, I think, So one point that I wanted to make here in this slide here is that manana can also include writing, you know. So this is something that is important to remember, that manana is not just thinking, it's also writing. You might write, you might summarize the paper that you've read. You might write a small piece of report or a summary, you know, an essay on what you've read, and you can share it with your peers. And that's also part of manana. You're trying to understand what the person has done, what research somebody has done already. You're not doing anything new here. You're not creating anything new, but you're trying to analyze using writing as a tool, you know. So writing is not just about communication. Writing is also a tool for research, you know. So writing can be seen as a tool for mananam, you know. So the other aspect I would mention in mananam is, you might ask the question, what happens if I violate or perturb the assumptions in the paper, you know? This in some sense you can say part of Nididhyasana also maybe, but why I put it in mananam is, it's a tool for investigation, you know, it's a tool for investigation, it's a tool for analysis. And you're trying to say, okay, if I perturb a little bit of the assumption, if I violate one assumption in the paper, what will happen, right? That actually answers the question, is it robust? Because sometimes, you know, people publish papers where the findings are not robust, you know, like if some assumption is violated, the inferences, the conclusions don't stand, the insights don't stand, you know, and such a work is not robust. Maybe in more hard sciences, it can be about statistical significance, error bars, you know, hypothesis testing. You can say those things come into picture here. Is it really robust? Is it like, there's something called surrogate testing, and, you know, so we do all that stuff. That's part of mananam here. You are asking the question, is it robust? And the other question that you're asking is it inevitable? You know, in other words, we're asking the question, why it has to be this way? You know, like the authors are proposing some new theory or a new way of arguing, a new theory or a new concept or a new method. Why is it has to be this way? Why not some other way, you know? Is it really inevitable? This is very, very useful in mathematics, you know, because in mathematics, sometimes we can see this in papers. We go through a paper and we, at the end of the great paper, we say, oh yeah, it has to be like this, you know, it can't be anything, any other way. that is amazing, you know. And when you come to that kind of a conclusion, you see that the power of the paper, you know. But it may not be true many times, right? It may not be the only way. There can be other ways. So it's not necessarily inevitable. So this is actually part of mananam, I would say. Again, as just my point of view. Okay. Niharika, are there any questions in the chat? I'm just curious.
Yes, there are some questions, sir.
Okay. We can take them. We can take them. Nice. Thank you for putting those lists here.
Yes, sir.
Niharika, thank you. That's really nice. Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah.
Shama Nuja Das. Sir, please go ahead with your question. Yeah.
Oh, okay. I am just curious to know, and since you, and probably you can be the best person to answer that because you come from that background. Going through the papers, as you said, the three pass method. See, informally, I think all of us do that, right?
True.
Now with so much of, you know, natural language based AI system coming, are there any tools that are there which can help us quickly put together final part? Of course, you have to do yourself. The first part can be shortened, and second part it can help. Third part, of course, you have to do. You cannot